Good morning and welcome to the third meeting of 2022 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies for this morning's meeting. Our first agenda item is to follow up session on budget scrutiny, and I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and I welcome our witnesses. Emma Cosgrove, Knowledge Exchange Fellow at the Fraser of Allender Institute. Dr. Angela O'Hagan, Chair of the Scottish Government Equality Budget Advisory Group, and Chris Burt, Associate Director for Scotland of the Joseph Rowntree Foundation. So thank you all for agreeing to give evidence today, and you're all very, very welcome to today's meeting. Can I please remind witnesses that if they wish to come in on any question, just to indicate that by typing R in the chat box, and I'll bring you in if time is available. But first of all, if I could invite each of our witnesses to make a short opening statement, starting with Emma Cosgrove, please.
Good morning. Just to correct the record, it's Emma Congreve rather than Cosgrove. It's a common mistake.
Apologies. I can actually see that. It's technically my fault.
Well, good morning. Thanks for inviting me back today. Just a couple of points. I'll keep it very short. So since we last spoke, we've had the next iteration of the Scottish budget, and in terms of looking at some of the issues that budget raises of interest as a committee, I would say that we are still seeing progress being made in terms of the attentions of policymakers and analysts looking at budget spend and looking at where those budget spends should or could have an impact on those with protected characteristics and those and income inequality. So I think we are further along than we were, say, a few years ago, where it could be quite difficult to even find numbers that related to budget spend that you could link to statements in the equality budget statement. So we definitely do welcome that there has been progress there in terms of that transparency. However, there is still some way to go. It's still very clear, I think, from reading the budget documents that the commentary and the kind of analysis that looks at some of the impacts on protected characteristics and income inequality is coming after the decisions have been made, and potentially after the spending allocations have been finalised. It's rare to see examples of where that type of analysis, where you are looking to find areas where more spend is required in order to tackle inequalities, is rare to find that then aligned to a level of budget spend with a follow-through analysis of the impact that that would be expected to have on the areas of concern. So it's still a bit of an after-the-event type analysis, and clearly in order to better meet targets and improve lives, you would want it to switch focus so that it is a very clear pathway between analysis of need and the money that is being allocated through the budget. And that's not just about the budget process, that's about the whole of the policy making process and improvements that need to be made there. And the second area where we would still like to see more progress is sort of the adding up of the spend that's allocated or thought to be related to some of the issues on equality and income inequality. So at the moment, there's a lot of figures in there. So 1 million here, 10 million there, 50 million here. But there's nowhere where you get a sense of the totality of that. So even in different portfolios, to what extent is some of the millions or whatever being represented there? What does that look like as a proportion of the overall portfolio spend? We're missing a lot of context there that actually helps you to understand how significant some of the spend is in the budget that's being allocated to different areas. So I think those are two areas where we would like to see improvement. But clearly, these improvements will take time, and we are making some progress, but still a way to go. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Emma. And can I ask Angela O'Hagan, please?
Good morning, convener and colleagues. Thank you very much. I would agree with much of what Emma has said. I think we can see some really significant improvements. I think particularly in the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement, presentationally, it is much more accessible. It's brings forward some, I mean, these sound maybe like quite simple points, but they're very important in terms of conveying information about the budget and the direction of travel. So, you know, including infographics on the budget is an important step. Equally, an important inclusion is the specific rights, the specific human rights that are engaged in the different portfolio spends. I think that's very important as part of the collective action that is needed to build knowledge and understanding on human rights. We've got a long way to go there, but we have high ambitions in that regard, but we need to be collectively working to build knowledge and understanding there. The annex attached to the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement is a tremendous resource. I think at 134 pages, it will be treated as a resource rather than a ready reckoner, but it provides that ready reckoner for parliamentarians, for those of us with an interest outside government to go to look for some of the specificity that Emma has highlighted across the portfolios. Again, there's a long way to go, but this is the second iteration of this approach, which hopefully is gaining some traction within the portfolios. And likewise, the framing around the 10 risks that helps concentrate analysis around key interventions and the spending allocated. Obviously, there's lots more that could be done, but they are, I think, some of the key improvements. There's always a but. Significant improvement really still necessary on the issues that Emma has raised. But I think overall, again and again, I come back to the conceptual approach that policymakers, that parliamentarians need to take in terms of tackling inequality, advancing equality and securing the realisation of rights. That has to be the starting point for analysis. And from that, the links to spend and the links to outcome evaluation will flow. And the final point I want to say by way of introduction is really welcome the positive reception of the EBAG report and our recommendations to government. And I'm looking forward to seeing the actions that the Scottish Government commits to, along with how the EBAG recommendations and the processes that we are trying to push and support will link with the other exercises within government on fiscal transparency within the Exchequer, the open government activity on open budgeting, and I'll say more about the busy year that there is for financial scrutiny with the various reviews of the fiscal framework and the resource spending review, all key opportunities to see some significant improvements.
Okay, thank you very much, Angela. Now ask Chris Burke, please.
Thanks, convener. I'll keep it brief and obviously associate myself with both Angela and Emma's comments that I would agree with. But just to note that since we last spoke with you, there's a lot of different things have happened. Our Poverty in Scotland report followed hot on the heels of our last session, which showed where we thought child poverty was going. We obviously had the budget itself. In just this week, we've had an important bit of work done by Emma and our colleagues at the Fraser Valander and the Poverty Alliance on action that could be taken to meet the child poverty targets. And just this morning, the Poverty and Inequality Commission have published their advice to the Scottish Government on the Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan. And the conclusion of all of these things, I think, is fairly consistent that there's a lot more to be done if we're going to meet our ambitions on child poverty, on reducing child poverty. And I think while some of the elements of the budget are more accessible in the ways particularly Angela has described, I think it would be really hard to draw a conclusion from the budgets as to its impact on child poverty. So I think there are particular areas of concern which I'm more than happy to discuss in questions with the members, but I'll leave it at that for now, convener. Thanks.
That's great. Thanks. Thanks to all of you. I wonder if I can now, we'll now go to questions from committee members. And again, remind folk from the panel that if you want to come in, please press R. Committee members will indicate which members they initially want a response from. But if you feel that you've particularly want to add as well, then please put R in the chat and we'll try and bring you in. We've got about an hour for this part of the session. So can I go to Maggie Chapman, please?
Thank you very much, Joe, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for being morning, and thank you for your opening remarks. It's good to hear that the recognition of this being part, I suppose, a process, that there have been improvements, but there is still considerable work to do, especially in particular areas. I would like to explore a couple of those in my initial question, if that's okay. And I suppose I'm struck by what you've said already about the adding up issue, not necessarily understanding exactly how allocations in the equalities and human rights space actually either connect to each other or add up. And I suppose I'm interested in how that relates to our structural equality analysis and our understanding of where the issues are, and maybe it's that kind of cart before horse thing, Emma, that you were talking about. But I'm wondering, maybe Emma, if I could start with you, could you say a little bit more about where we should be looking at the moment for that kind of structural equality analysis, and what it is that we need to do to build on that for future budgets, given that we know that this budget probably doesn't meet all of our ambitions. Particularly, I suppose, you know, around if we take a specific lens of that, the intersectional gender budgeting frame of that. But yeah, interested in your thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you. So happy to answer that. So we did speak a lot at the last session about data limitations, and I won't go over that just in answer to this question. But clearly there are, you know, we're not in a perfect world where we have all of the data that we would like in order to be able to understand some of the scale of the issues that are that need to be addressed. But certainly we have enough data to know where there are issues that need to be resolved. Hence we have things like the NPF that you know, shows where the government is aiming in terms of policy priorities. So, I mean, I can talk about gender a little bit, but it might make sense to talk about child poverty. Chris mentioned that we put out a report this week, which tried to look at some of the big levers that are available to the Scottish Government and looked at how you could break those down in terms of policy. So we talk about childcare, employability, and social security, and look at how you could break those down to understand how many people do we think that this policy is going to affect, and what do we think the impact is going to be on household incomes as a result. So those two steps were the key part. So some of this you have to make assumptions, but you would expect policymakers to be thinking through those steps as they make their policy. And when you look at adding those up, you add them all up to household incomes. And then what you can do is then look at what that means. When you add that up for all households that get more money, you can then look at what that does to poverty and how far that takes you towards the poverty targets. So it's a model, and so it's not perfect. People may disagree on the assumptions, but where possible, you base it on evidence that you have from evaluations, for example, which is what we did in our model. And then you can start to see, okay, so this policy will have, you know, it's going to cost this much, we think it will affect this many people, this is the effect on incomes broadly, and this is what it will do for child poverty. So that's the type of adding up that we mean. Of course, where you've got intersectional issues, things are, you know, gender is a key part of that, because a lot of the child poverty measures will improve, you know, income support for women as well. But you have to sort of think about how you separate those things out, and you can just be very transparent about the fact that things will overlap, and you know, and in some cases you may want to be clear who the primary beneficiary is intended to be, and go through a process where you add those things up, so that you can actually see, you know, the purposeful intent of policy. But it certainly is possible to do it in this kind of systematic way that I've talked about. And it's certainly possible to do for things around income, because of the surveys that exist on household incomes and the types of models that are available. So that's an example of how, yeah, of what I mean there, and something that could be done on the back of a budget type analysis if there was more information kind of that talked about. So this, we know how much is spent on policy lines, and but actually following that through a little bit further, the numbers that we want is how many people is that expected to impact, and what do we expect that impact to be, and then you can start actually doing something that adds those things up to look at the scale of the impact.
Thank you very much, Emma. That's really, really helpful. I know Chris wants to. I see Chris wanting to come in the chat as well. Chris, over to you, and then I'll ask Angela as well.
Thanks. Just to take a sort of specific example, I mean, if you look at the equality statement, buses in particular seem to be a cure for many things. So there's hundreds of millions of pounds to be invested in them, and it's noted throughout that women tend to use buses more, people on low incomes tend to use buses more, disabled people can benefit from free bus travel, etc. But it seems to be trying to do things for all people, and there's very little insight into what specific impact it's going to have for those people. So we know that the travel patterns at the moment, at least, for women and men might be different. So how is bus travel adjusting to that? If disabled people have the access to free travel, but is it the travel that they can actually use? Is it available? Is it accessible? These are the sorts of information that you just can't see from this. So we have kind of bland lines which say, oh, you know, women use buses and we're spending lots of money on it, but that's not telling us anything really.
Thanks, Chris. That's helpful. Yeah, there is a kind of a gap, isn't there, between the statement and the annex, and then the level four data, and there's something missing in between all of that. Angela, I wonder if I could bring you in as well, and because you talked about the need for collective action, and I suppose this is part of one of the things I'm really, really interested in is how we break down some of the departmental silos. And I think we've got to this point because departmental budgets have been, for understandable reasons, so fiercely protected, and not actually the connections between them or the overlaps between them seen very clearly. And I wonder if you could just pick up on that as it relates to the broader question. Thank you.
Well, indeed. I mean, I think this is something we've been talking about for a very long time. Improving the relationship between different portfolios, and that's absolutely central to the recommendations from EBAG, that there are a number of ways to approach some of that, breaking down some of that siloed thinking. I think we've seen some improvements, but we focused on sharing information, building knowledge and competence in equality and human rights analysis, but also just understanding human rights, what that means, what equality analysis looks like. And I'm not just talking about the way that equality impact assessment is currently conducted. That's quite often not equality analysis. And the culture around policy making and public finance decision making, and some of the hierarchies and separations between functions that may continue to exist and which do inhibit a more collaborative way of working. I think EBAG has been, the feedback about EBAG from policymakers within government has been very positive, because it brings together finance, strategy and performance, analytical services division, and the equality and human rights directorate, as well as our external members. So it holds a very unique place there. But there's a big job to do in government and I think in Parliament as well, in terms of the kind of scrutiny. And it goes to my opening point, the collective action needs to be from a common understanding and commitment to identifying the structural inequalities that you've talked about, understanding what causes and reproduces them and addressing those causes. And yes, we need good data, but an intersectional approach to eliminating existing inequalities, advancing equality and realising rights is not just about counting people. It's about understanding how racialised discrimination and marginalisation compounds and is compounded by class and income inequality, produces and reproduces health inequalities and cuts through and is cut through by gender. We really need to be improving the understanding and knowledge around that of policymakers and others. Now, the National Advisory Council on Women and Girls made a recommendation that there should be a statutory footing for intersectional gender budgeting. Now, that's a very welcome reminder to government, but it's already implicit, it's already there, the requirement for that in the Public Sector Equality Duty and the Equality Act 2010. What is missing is the practice. And so there's opportunity there to address some of that collective action through the review of the Public Sector Equality Duty, as well as the different reforms to the budget and public finance processes that are going to happen this year.
Thank you very much. I'll leave it there, Joe.
Okay, thank you. And if we could go to Alexander Stewart, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Thank you for your opening statements. You've talked about the pressures that of transparency and also the sort of journey that we're on in trying to ensure that there is delivery of equality and human rights budgeting processes. But I think that in the current circumstances, there are still challenges and major pressures that are affecting and will affect the delivery of equalities and human rights budgeting in the coming years. But also we have now the added difficulty of the pandemic and the effects of that, and how it may unwind some of the priorities that were set and how that is managed for the future. So it would be quite useful to get a flavour, maybe from Emma first and then Angela, about what they see as these challenges that we face in ensuring, because by allocating funds and supporting the way forward, it may be derailed, or it may be knocked back, or it may even be knocked off course because of the priorities that may now face us in the next few years as to how we can manage and unwind all of that.
Thanks very much. I'm happy to come in there. So I think it's a really important point you're raising, because there will be big challenges for understanding what's happening in Scotland across the board in terms of everything was thrown up in the air. It's partly still up in the air, and we're yet to really understand where those pieces are going to fall. And for statisticians, that's an absolute nightmare, because when you have these unexpected events, not only does it make the data very hard to interpret in terms of understanding, trends, like a year-on-year change in some data, it could it be because of the pandemic, or is it because the quality of the data that was able to be collected during the pandemic just fell considerably? And so it's going to be really difficult to interpret what's happening or what happened basically since 2020 onwards. And it's probably not going to be for a few years until that is really understood. So that obviously puts policymakers in a very difficult position in terms of trying to interpret and trying to know what has been knocked off course and what's what needs to be the focus. So so it is going to be a few years where we have to really take a broader approach to trying to understand what's happening, rather than just relying on what we do on some of the kind of key statistics that say households below average income is the key statistical source for a lot of data on incomes. That's going to be very difficult to interpret over the next few years. That means things like the child poverty targets, it might become very difficult to actually understand whether we are on course towards them. It's going to be very difficult to understand the impact of some of the, working from home, schools closing, and the long-term impacts that will have on women's earnings in the labour market, for example. It may have been that promotions were missed, priorities had to be changed. So all of those things will take years to understand. But policymakers, I mean, in a way, we know what a lot of the challenges are in terms of, say, the labour market, in terms of what sectors have suffered the most, where there are skill shortages, and actually there are opportunities there for where you could think about reskilling different parts of the population and a lot of the low-paid jobs where there's been a lot of upheaval, are those that ideally we'd be thinking about through inequalities and human rights perspective. So those things are known. So what we really need to be thinking about is where should the priorities be for the government, and trying to help them understand what's likely to have got worse, what's likely to have got better, and what don't we know. And through all of that, actually, what should the priorities be? So can't fix everything before we know what all the problems are potentially. I'm not sure the priorities of the government will have changed through the pandemic. I think a lot of things have got worse for a lot of people, but they are the same people who were struggling before the pandemic. So if you're thinking about it on that basis, it's a real kind of steadfast, okay, we need to carry on. The national performance framework still stands. But within that, there needs to be that kind of flexibility, I suppose, to realise what has changed and where, things might need to be ramped up in response to things like the cost of living crisis that's now coming down the line. So it's a difficult place to be as a policymaker, and I think we have to realise that. That doesn't mean that the priorities that existed before the pandemic are not the same ones that would exist afterwards.
Thank you. And Angela, you talked about your opening statement about how it affected individuals and organisations across the piece. How do you see the priorities changing and having to be adapted to encourage that process to ensure that people are not lost or fall through the net?
Thank you very much. I think I'll start where, in trying to answer your question of where Emma left off, that the pandemic has revealed, as well as exacerbating, but also revealed the existing inequalities. Pandemic has made them worse. Some policy choices made those things worse. Existing isolation, existing health inequalities, etc., made the effects of the pandemic worse. And so if anything, that means we need gender budgeting, equalities and human rights budgeting as our cornerstone approach, much more so than ever. It's not a case of, well, we need to set that aside while we focus on other things. It's a process, it's an approach to policymaking that will help reveal the kinds of dynamics in the data, the dynamics in the outcomes that Emma was talking about. I think as well there is a role for improved parliamentary scrutiny and using the different points in the budget process throughout the cycle for that back and forwards look at allocations and outcomes, and focusing on the policy outcomes there rather than the political the politics of the budget, but focus on the policy and outcomes from spending allocations and policy priorities, and taking decisions and supporting decisions to reorientate spend and policy priorities where necessary. And the other thing I wanted to say is about using the human rights standards, using human rights as a framework. Are basic rights to food, to security, to housing, to health, to education, are they being realised? Is that floor in place? Is that minimum core there, and how to build on that minimum core? Has there been regression, that unwinding that you talked about in your question? You know, are things being rolled back? Well, they can't roll back. We have a legal duty to avoid that, as well as other political and moral imperatives. Is the policy discriminatory or having unequal or different outcomes? Well, we know that through, or we should be know, we should know those things through improved data and the kinds of analysis that Emma has talked about. And the final thing, I mean, the two points really on the National Performance Framework, which has huge potential, but I think we need to be seeing more specific and dynamic actions more clearly linked to spend and outcomes through the MPF. And the final point I wanted to make was about the Social Renewal Advisory Board and its set of calls to action that give a set of very specific recommendations that directly link to pre-existing inequalities and the conditions produced through the pandemic, but actions that can be pinpointed and scrutinised as we move to the next stages out the pandemic, and linked to the National Strategy for Economic Transformation that's coming down the line, linked to other strategies, and making those linkages across these big set pieces much clearer. And I think, those of us who push for this transparency externally, for parliamentarians, to be pushing for those links across these big set piece strategies to be made much more transparent, and to be made more transparent through the budget and reporting as well.
Thank you. And I think, Chris, you want to come in as well?
Sure. It's just to highlight and underline the point that both Angela and Emma have made about the pandemic really highlighting and exacerbating existing inequalities. Now, it has created new problems for people, but I think what it's shown us is basically how the immune system of our economy and public services work and who it works to protect. We've seen people on middle and higher incomes able to save more money, while those on low incomes are piling up debt. We've seen people in our more deprived back communities twice as likely to die from COVID, and those in minority ethnic communities significantly more likely to die from COVID. We've seen those shielding have their inability to travel, to go to work, to socialise with their friends exacerbated in a way which it would have existed prior to pandemic, but now has become crushing. So I think the impacts of a pandemic should be a warning to us. The immune system of our country to shocks like this does not protect the very people that your committee is striving to improve the lives of.
Thank you, convener.
Okay, thank you. And can we now go to Karen Adam, please?
Thank you, convener. I just want to thank the panel for the extensive answers so far. And I'm probably going to ask a question you've touched on in the last two answer sessions there. But really, the committee has started exploring what a human rights-based approach to budgeting could mean, and the recommendations to integrate intersectional gender analysis into the Scottish budget process have been clear. But can I ask, what's that practically going to look like? We know that investment in particular areas can have unintended consequences, good and bad. So along with what the practicalities of what that investment looks like, what outcomes are we looking to see from that? And as I'll just come in with my second question just now. So how much of this is mitigation? We have at the moment, rising food costs, energy costs and rents. And we know that this is going to disproportionately affect women even more. Is there anything that we can do to ensure that we're making the most of the money for long-term vision? We have the pandemic, but we also have the EU exit that's compounded a lot of these issues. So what I'm trying to say is when we have this money, we're trying to get these particular outcomes from the investment in these areas, but really what is that practically looking like, and what exactly can we do to ensure it's getting to the people that needs it the most and it's going to help and support them long term? Can I start with Dr. O'Hagan? Thank you.
I had a feeling you were coming there. thank you very much. Wow, what a huge question. A human rights based approach, as I say, if we work to minimum core and as the very basics of what should be happening, and if we're not already doing that, then there's a clear starting point in those areas. If that's not happening, if policy is not, doesn't have a clear objective in terms of making sure people have, a decent income, if access to safe and secure housing, safe and secure space, freedom from violence, access to food. And we're dealing with these basics. Nearly 25% of children in Scotland are living in poor households. How can that be tolerated? And so it's about expressing policy priorities that recognise the current state of play and what causes those inequalities and driving resources to address them. And again, going back to Social Renewal Advisory Board, part of how the public sector works together and works in concert with the community sector and the voluntary sector is absolutely key to this. So there's a big how as well as the what that we need to be working on. Yes, there are unintended consequences of policies, but if the better that we get collectively at the upfront analysis, that starting point that that seeks to identify what's currently happening and why, then the better we should be at making much more targeted interventions. How much of it is mitigation? That links to Emma's points about shifting priorities, the cost of living squeeze, decisions around council tax, decisions around tax policy in general, are all held in that very fine balance between these different variables and how they interact. But if the starting point is always brought, if we always come back to the starting point about what are the transformations that public policy and public finance is seeking to achieve, then that has that gives a kind of guiding through that. Very quickly, there's the recent publication in Italy of their gender budgeting, the Italian government's gender budgeting approach, takes a really interesting approach and does some very useful things. It's a good framework. They've got a range of useful categories that I think we could learn from, including revenue and tax policy analysis, as well as time use and care, labour market policy, legislation, policy and government employment. And they categorise spending along these three criteria, gender inequalities, addressing gender inequalities, gender sensitive expenditure and neutral expenditure. And that's quite a useful way, I think, to try and structure some of our thinking. To link it to a couple of points from earlier, and then I'll stop. But the OECD have recommended over many years that the approach to equality analysis in the budget process should happen in three stages: an ex ante, so the policy formulation and appraisal; the concurrent, so the scrutiny of policy as it's being implemented; and ex post, what happened as a result of those policy decisions. And that's something we're trying to build into the budget review way back in 2016. And there's still room for significant improvement there in that process within the budget cycle and in the parliamentary scrutiny.
Thank you. I see, is it Chris wants to come in there?
Thanks, Karen. I think a key thing here is we have to, all the points Emma and Angela have made about the importance of getting the right data is absolutely key and will be the only thing that allows us to kind of shift course if we start to get things wrong. But we also, as shown by the pandemic, we also can't wait for perfection. So that bus example I gave earlier to Maggie is a really good example. Is we're kind of throwing a big chunk of money at an issue, but we're mitigating, say, a cost. We're saying, oh, transport can be expensive, so we'll make that free. Well, that's fine, and that mitigates that cost. But structurally, we have a transport system which is set up, focused on urban areas, focused on traditional commuting, and we know that that discriminates against women in particular, or carers, or all of these things. So how do you make the decisions to drive a different outcome of people being able to travel between caring spaces and work rather than just directly to work? And how do we know whether or not that's working and having the outcomes that we want to see? You have to just, there are, you do have to get to a point where you do have to just kind of suck it and see where you get to. So I do think, I think it's important that in these areas, we can't expect things to happen from general policy by osmosis to have magical impacts on groups if we don't target them to do that. So I think that targeting and then knowing whether or not it works is really important.
Thank you. And Emma.
Thanks. So on the question on gender, intersectional gender analysis, so I thought it might be worth reminding the committee that there's been some work done on it's called a gender, Scotland's Gender Equality Index. So that's been produced by some analysts within the Scottish Government. And that's the kind of place where we would see analysis for the issue. We could start with that. So that goes through a number of different areas, some of which Angela mentioned there in terms of time use, issues around power, and looking into areas around violence against women. Looks through a whole stretch of different types of indicators that are important, and it shows how Scotland's doing on those indicators. So that could be a really good starting point for a piece of budget analysis that goes, okay, so these are the things that are important. This is where Scotland is on some of them. And so how do the decisions in the budget align to those, or even better, before the budget happens, what kind of things could make a difference there? What kind of numbers are we talking about? And what is that pathway through to the impact? So it's using those kind of tools. There is a lot of data that already exists, and a lot of good work goes into looking at some of the issues and trying to help break them down. It's that bit that we're missing that connects that to actual policy making and budget allocations. So I think that's one example of where we could look to in terms of what it would look like, and that could be a place to start. And that does lead on to think about some of the issues around the longer term, because obviously we know a lot of the issues for women, particularly mothers, are around care, and be that care for children, and then and care for older relatives as well. So that infrastructure in terms of childcare and potentially the National Care Service, they're the type of long term structural changes that could actually be shifting these things over the long term and help in the short term as well. So I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, can we go to Pam Duncan-Glancy now, please?
Thank you, convener, and thank you to the panel for joining us this morning and for all your evidence. I've been struck by a lot of what you said, and in particular, I have to say, the immune system response in the economy has really struck a chord this morning, so thank you for that, and thank you also for the submissions you've given in writing. I have a few questions, if the convener will indulge, and the panel will indulge me. The first one I have is to touch on where Emma has just highlighted, and that's around care. And the Scottish Women's Budget Group described action on the care, but on care in the budget as an opportunity missed. And I have to say I would agree with that. And so I wondered perhaps if Dr. O'Hagan, you could perhaps tell us a little bit about your views on that in terms of paid care, your expectations and your view on the wage floor of £10.50 per hour, how that will impact on women's inequality, and also in terms of unpaid carers. So we know that unpaid carers have faced a significant increase in the number of hours they're providing care. We know that has an impact on their ability to work in the workplace, and not least also on their own personal circumstances. Last year, the government, as you'll know, introduced a bill to double the carers allowance supplement in December, and an uplift it introduced during the pandemic to recognise this additional responsibility. And at the time, the government said that it included the provision in the bill for it to be doubled again this year in regulations, but the draft budget doesn't include that. So I'd be keen to know if the panel have any concerns about this and whether they expect what they expect the impact on the ability of carers to realise and enjoy their rights to be if this was not, for example, to be doubled. And then I have a couple of other areas that I'll come back to that's probably enough to go on just now. Thanks.
Yeah, Pam, if we can, we'll go to the other members and hopefully come back to you if you've got a different area as well.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for those questions, Pam. The Scottish Women's Budget Group response did indeed say it was an opportunity missed, and that the £10.50 wage floor was a good starting point, but it had to be seen as a starting point. Is, you know, as they say, it's only a first step, and it's a first step in recognising or shifting the dial a little bit on valuing care and the provision of care. But I still have some deep-seated concerns about how care is conceptualised and how care is being approached within economic policy making. I think there is a disjuncture between seeing care and social care in a health context and not in an economic context. The care economy is at the heart of our economy. I mean, it follows on from Chris's analogy as well around the immune system. Unpaid care supports any so-called productive economy. And unless we recognise that, and unless that care is valued in a monetary sense as well as conceptually and politically, then economic strategies are not going to deliver transformative economic policy outcomes. And that means investing in care as our infrastructure, as part of our infrastructure, investing in quality services that are not subject to, you know, postcode lottery, but still give the flexibility for the person in receipt of care services, as well as unpaid carers. And unpaid carers are consistently, I think, ignored and overlooked. And the carers lobby is very clear and very strong on that. I think it links to Maggie's earlier point about consistency across policy portfolios, and that care is not just in the domain of social care, but care should be front and centre in a whole range of policies, including, as Chris has said, in transport and recognising care journeys and so on. I mean, again, it comes back to the starting point for policy, thinking about carers' allowance supplement or additional payments to carers. The starting point should not be a formulaic and rather mendacious, not in intent necessarily, but in execution approach that wants to know exacting numbers of hours that carers provide to and how that is distributed between different people they care for. That absolutely is the wrong starting point for policy making around supporting people whose income is severely curtailed because of the care that they are providing to one and multiple people. And so if the policy decision-making process is to activate, is to give effect to those political commitments around being, as stated in the programme for government, about being a caring nation, a land of opportunity, an economy that works for all and people living better, then that has to start with valuing and investing in care.
Thank you. I think I see that possibly Chris and others are looking to come in, if that's okay, convener. And then I have one short follow-up still on the theme of human rights and inequality. Thank you.
Okay, I'll go first, that's okay, Chris. Just following on briefly, so with the issues around care and the the absence of a lot on that in the last budget. I think that was something that we also reflected on. It's something that we expect to now be more of a focus, in the next few months, next six months, I think, as the government brings forward new proposals on the National Care Service and how that then goes into the bill process. So we will be expecting that analysis that you would have expected to see or hope to see in the budget will start to come through in the next few months. Particularly, there'll be a financial memorandum, hopefully, that will be very detailed in terms of the impact. Certainly something we're looking at sort of independently in terms of understanding what the proposals for future improvements will be and what that will correspond to in terms of the cost. And we'd expect then that will follow through to future budgets in terms of that will be reflected in allocations, and there will be a clear read across between the proposals, the bill, and then future budgets. That doesn't always happen. There's not always that kind of read across that we'd like to see. So this will be a really, hopefully, an example of where we can, in real time, see that happening. And if it's not happening, that's a time where we can raise the questions as to why it's not. I do understand that. Yeah, there wasn't a lot in the budget, but in a way, because of the way the process is moving and the consultation and the proposals we're hopefully getting soon, that should still be to come, hopefully. So I'll stop there.
Just very quickly to add to Angela's point on care, which I think I would firmly associate myself with, is that if you think about the impacts of the pandemic, who could have suffered more than unpaid carers or low-income single parents, for example? In this, the impact of the pandemic has been absolutely crushing. And when we talk about that immune system, is that those people have been the immune system for so many people, but yet have received so little support to do so. And I think that's morally wrong, but also for the reasons that Angela's set out, completely misunderstands its impact on the economy. So I think it's why things like the minimum income guarantee are really important, because this provides a way for us to rethink the value that we put on care in every shape and form in our society. And it's absolutely key that we do that properly.
Thank you for all of that, and again for further immune system. It's a really strong one. The other question I have is around, also around social security, and it's around Scottish Child Payment and the fact that 170,000 children receive the Scottish Child Payment through the bridging payment. But my understanding is it's not yet been doubled, and I wonder if Chris could comment on the impact that not doubling it for that group might have.
Well, I mean, I think I've spoken at length about how we want that to happen as quickly as possible. I think in the context of the rising cost of living this year, particularly we hear a lot about the energy cap moving. For some people, I think the uplift in the energy cap is going to be about the equivalent of those bridging payments. I think the full rollout to all children can't come soon enough. And I hope, I'm pretty sure that the Scottish Government, the agency, will be working to do that as quickly as they possibly can, because it will be an enormous boost to families, and the families that are getting it do talk about its positive impacts. But yes, you're right, Pam, it can't come soon enough.
Thank you. Thanks,
Camilla. Okay, thank you. Can I go to Pam Goswell, please?
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel, and thank you for your opening statements and all the detailed responses you've been giving to all the questions today. My question comes really in the back of what Pam's just talked about, a little bit about the child payment. So the question is around the Joseph Rowntree Foundation expressed that the Scottish Government's plan to double the child payment by the end of 2022 is on its own not enough to meet the child poverty target. And given that councils are responsible for vital service provisions, with council cuts could impact the services provisions available to children living in poverty. So what do you feel can be done to improve the coordination of policies across all the areas of the budget so that where one has a positive effect, it is not negated by a policy in another area? And my question would go to probably Chris first, and then others. Thank you.
Thanks, Pam. I think it's absolutely vital that all policies pushing in the same direction. If we're talking about a national mission to end child poverty, this should impact on everyone working across public services. And I think there are areas where we do have to think really carefully about where the impacts of one thing is negating the positive impact of something else. So, for example, increases in council tax will impact more on low-income families than they will comparatively to those who are better off. And with rising energy bills, etc., again, that has greater impact on those with low incomes than it does for those with higher incomes. So while the increase of the child payment will be positive and should be positive in terms of the overall numbers of child poverty, because of those other things, its impact on people's quality of life will be held back. And in terms of wider council services, those can be vital in helping families get by. So the commitment to the family wellbeing services, which were announced in the budget, were very welcome in that regard. But I do think, increasing Social Security while stripping back other services is not going to reduce child poverty in the sustainable way that I think we all want to see.
Thank you, Chris. I'm not sure if any Emma or Angela want to come in on this.
Can I jump in very quickly on a point about the process point you made across portfolios? And it links to a number of questions that have been offered by the committee members this morning. And that, to use really old-fashioned language, and I think I say that every time I say this to this and other committees, that joined up thinking, but it's combined. The point I want to make is about making linkages across portfolios and recognising that equality and human rights are relevant to all portfolios. And so that in the future, we don't see statements like that from the Rural Affairs and Islands portfolio that says this spend does not tend to reduce inequalities for groups with protected characteristics. That is, I think, an unacceptable statement in the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement. Now, it's maybe been some unfortunate editing and shorthanding, but does it point to a lack of understanding, a lack of analysis? What's really meant by that? How does that portfolio know that inequalities are not addressed? Now, there may be some spending lines which, to use the Italian categorisation, are neutral, others sensitive, and others specifically around addressing inequalities. But that analysis has to happen before you could even contemplate a statement like that. And I'm not convinced, given the surrounding statements and analysis, that it has. So those weaknesses across government we still see in some of the presentations in the Equality and Fairer Scotland statements and in the budget, as Emma really clearly and articulated at the top of the meeting.
Thank you. That's me. Unless Emma wants to come in. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks. Then, can I go to Fulton McGregor, please?
Thanks, convener. I think that's me on. Yep. Yep. Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. I think I'm very impressed with the quality of the responses so far. It's been a really, really good session, and I want to thank the panel for that. I wanted to ask a question around about tax policy, and I'll just put this out there to the panel. What do you think? How do you think the Scottish Government could use tax policy in order to meet human rights and equalities obligations. And I'm quite happy to start in any order, convener, anybody who wants to come in on that.
Have you? Okay.
Oh, well, I'll start with Chris Bill.
Yeah, right, okay.
I think we touched on this partly in our previous session. Is obviously the way that you raise tax is very important. I think, like most people in the Parliament, really, we would urge that to be in as progressive a way as possible, i.e. very much related to your ability to pay. So for those on lower incomes to be contributing less. So for example, the income tax system is generally progressive, which is good, and the Scottish Government have taken steps in the last few years to make that certainly more progressive than the UK system. But I mean, I do think the comparison with the UK system shouldn't be top of our mind when we're talking about impacting child poverty. But ultimately, what makes the biggest impact is how you then spend that money. So it then becomes, okay, if we've raised more money and we've done that in a progressive way, that's good. How are we going to spend that to redistribute income across our economy? But I think the area where I'd certainly like to see, I think we need a big debate about this in Scotland, and it can be led from the Parliament, it can be led from the government, it doesn't really matter, but how wealth is distributed across our economy in Scotland, because income inequality is bad in Scotland, wealth inequality is eye-watering, and that is the sort of thing which is locking people in poverty over time. And a lot of that is related to our housing market. Our housing market is often the economic security that lots of families have, and the idea for a lot of people on low incomes to access, get on the property ladder, is a pipe dream. And I do think that's something that we need to look at.
Thanks very much for that. Dr. O'Hagan, I see you're voting in as well.
Yes, thank you very much. I'll take off my chair of the Equality Budgets Advisory Group hat, because I have no policy role there. But as somebody who's part of the Human Rights Budgeting Working Group and a member of the Scottish Women's Budget Group, I've got quite a lot to say on tax. One of the things as well is to say we're moving, I think, to a more open conversation with government, the Scottish Government, about tax. There was, opportunity, some of it missed in the recent tax policy consultation. But again, I would echo many of the points that Chris has just made. The positive flexibilities around income tax, but there needs, I think, to be, yes, the debate that Chris talks about, but some political boldness across the piece and across the parties in relation to having a conversation with the public about the central role of taxation in raising revenue for the quality and character of public services that we want to have. And that means being prepared as well to look at a range of tax instruments, which can and, in my opinion, should include wealth taxes, re-looking at land value tax and valuation of property. Obviously, that links to council tax and its fitness for purpose, really, as a funding mechanism, which then, of course, then links us into Chris's point about how tax, how revenue is allocated, and the process of allocation on one-year cycles as opposed to three-year cycles, which at the moment inhibits longer-term planning and sustainable services. So I think we need to see revenue raising in step with allocation processes and the purposes of allocation. But I think the point for me to underline is boldness, really, in tax, and not shying away from having conversations about taxation and tax policy in Scotland that are about raising the revenue that is necessary to deliver the quality and character of public services that we all would like to see.
Thank you for that, Dr. O'Hagan. Emma Congreve, are you voting in on this question?
Yeah, I will throw in a few points. So, one thing we've talked about a lot at the Fraser of Allender Institute is about having that kind of grown-up discussion on tax. And obviously, we do have a progressive income tax policy in place, and more progressive than south of the border. But some of the decisions that are made at budget time on income tax sometimes look like they are, going to help lower income households, and then actually when you look into the detail of them, it's not quite as clear cut as that. So we would really like to see. So I'll give the example of this year with increases to the starter and basic rates of inflation of income tax being raised by inflation. So that when you looked into the detail of that, that didn't mean actually that the rate at which you start to pay tax and would rise by the rate of inflation. What it meant instead that the size of the income bands above the personal allowance increased by inflation, and that actually had an impact when you look at some of the amounts of people pay. So that compared to a decision to freeze thresholds in cash terms, the uprating that they did meant that those who were earning above £25,000, gained by just under £5 a year, but those earning below £25,000 and above the personal allowance benefited by less than £1 a year. So those kind of issues that come up when you look into the detail of some of these things kind of say to us that there isn't, necessarily kind of that, there's not that level of transparency that we would really like to see, and that kind of intelligent conversation with the population and the parliament sometimes in terms of some of these decisions. And we saw something a little bit odd in non-domestic rates, where this kind of they won this desire to make Scotland tax policy look good in reference to the UK policy on it, meant that there was a slightly below what the UK government put in place increase in the poundage rate for income tax, and that only for non-domestic rates, sorry, and that only led to about a saving to businesses of around £30 a year, probably immaterial, but it will have had a big impact in terms of the amount of money that would have been lost from that budget because of that decision that has been made, and that then has impacts elsewhere. So it is really that kind of that conversation that we need to have about tax, so that everyone understands what's going on, that we're not, we use the phrase tax gimmicks almost to say that, we're not being as straightforward as we need to be in terms of our conversations about tax. So they're the type of things that I think are really important, that as more levers and as more difficult decisions on tax need to be made, that people really understand what's going on.
Thank you. I'm happy with that, convener.
Sorry, I noticed from the chat that Angela has a little point she wants to make, so maybe it's better making it so that it's on the record, Angela.
Thanks very much, convener. I just meant to say, in terms of a human rights-based approach, we would clearly argue that one of the requirements, the legal requirement through the International Convention on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, places a duty on states to secure the to maximise available resources, and that's about effective and efficient tax policy to secure the progressive realisation of rights. And so we have a legal requirement, and certainly if the incorporation of the conventions goes ahead in the way that we would like to see it, so that which drives compliance, but much more than compliance, it is about the flexibilities, the boldness, and the innovation and inventiveness, not the gimmicks that Emma has referred to, but to really, I think, continue in good faith the positive conversations that are ongoing about tax policy. And there's been a lot of effort from the Exchequer to improve that. So we're on the right road, but there's a lot more positive work to do.
Thanks very much, Angela. Can I go to Pam Duncan-Glancy, please?
Thank you, convener, for allowing me to come back in. I just want to take the opportunity, if that's okay, Emma, to ask a question about the report that you guys published yesterday. The that you've obviously noted that the Scottish Fiscal Commission has a disappointing outlook, basically, and that they've revised their tax take downward. I wonder if you could tell us what is your analysis of the reason for that downward revision, and what do you think the implications for the budget on Equalities could be? And then in addition to that, the area that you talk about or you describe the effect of using social security kind of versus, although I know it's not as simple as that, using social security and longer term economic policy and employment, and the impact that some employment policies can have on Equalities groups and protected characteristics and their ability to work. So I wonder if you could say a little bit more on that analysis, just to help us understand the impact both in terms of tax take for Equalities, but also in terms of how much money we're going to have to be able to address some of these inequalities.
Thank you. So the Fiscal Commission's forecast that came out at the time of the budget did have relatively bad news in it in terms of income tax forecasts. So they did revise downwards their forecast of income tax revenues for the years 2022-23. And this is due to basically lower earnings growth than was expected, based on the fact that unemployment and earnings have grown less quickly in Scotland compared to the rest of the UK since 2016-17. And through the mechanisms of fiscal framework, that means that there will be less money forecast to come into the Scottish budget. So that was one of the sort of key stories from the budget in terms of those kind of that part of your question. I mean, thinking ahead in terms of the policies that can and potentially reverse some of what we've seen there in terms of tackling poverty and inequality, one of the key routes to do that is through improving access to the labour market. So the report you referred to, we published yesterday, looked at some of the structural barriers and how they could be removed. And they were childcare in particular. It was a child poverty report, so this is for parents and mothers in particular, and the kind of skills and help with CVs, the employability type support that exists. So they are relatively expensive policies to do. You can see them as in forms of a big investment, though, both in people and in the economy. The returns over time, in terms of that boost to what we'd call the supply side of the economy, so the number of people working, the number of hours that people are able to put forward, and the productivity because of the less stressful environment that they are trying to deal with living in poverty. We couldn't quantify that last bit, but the other two we did try to look at. So you do get big payback, I suppose, in terms of that investment. It then just feeds through to things like tax revenues if you're able to improve people's access to work. But I think one thing our report did find is that when you were looking at what our assumptions would be in terms of, so to what extent would 50 hours of childcare remove barriers to work for women, for mothers, it was clear that if you look at the data that we tried to use as a comparison, it's clearly not just childcare that's the barrier to work. And I think this obviously goes back to what Chris was talking about in terms of transport. It's the cost of commuting, it's whether there's a bus to get you to work at the right time and get you to school to pick up your kids. It's whether or not there's the right job for the right schools in your area. So there's so many factors that centering on that. But if the government can start to pick off barriers as it goes, that would obviously be an improvement. The report we did also looked at social security, which is a really direct way, of course, of getting money into people's pockets. When you start raising those amounts, there will always be questions raised about what the other impacts of those are on things like work incentives. To be honest, I don't think the academic evidence on this is clear cut, particularly there have been changes in the structure of the economy and over the past 10 years or so, and the pandemic will have changed things again. So understanding how people make those decisions is difficult. But certainly putting money into people's pockets, because people on lower incomes tend to spend more of the money because they need to on essentials, you do get a boost to the economy to do that as well. So it's not putting money, one of the key things in my report is putting money into tackling poverty and getting money to people who say, you know, who can't work as a result of caring responsibilities, if you have very young children or their own disability or ill health, that has benefits for the economy too. You know, we shouldn't be thinking that this is a zero sum game in terms of putting money in and getting nothing back out again. And yeah, coming back to your original point, if we think about it in budgetary terms, that could come back in terms of beneficial income tax revenues as well in the future. Hope that answered enough of your question.
Yeah, I think Chris is hoping to come in and answer that question as well.
Yeah, just to follow up briefly, because I think it's really important to gently remind everyone across the political spectrum in the Parliament that they've all signed up to these child poverty targets by 2030, which means a very different Scotland to the one we have today. So what Emma's report has helpfully highlighted is some of the choices and trade-offs that are included in that. And as Emma has said, and I would probably say more forcefully, a fairer Scotland with very low levels of poverty will be a better country than the one that we have today. And I think that's something that we can all sign up to, but we're not going to get there by accident. We can't just tootle along as we are now and make those changes. So we do need to have big discussions about, for example, the value of care, as we've talked about there. And there isn't a free way of doing this. We can change the ways in which we spend money, of course. It doesn't need to all be a discussion about tax, but there are big questions in this, but big changes need to happen. Everyone has signed up to it, so we all kind of need to get on with doing it, I suppose.
Thanks very much. Thanks, Chris, and thanks, Pam, for the questions. Ed, we've got Maggie Chapman, please.
Very much. Thanks very much, Joe, and sorry for coming back in. I know we've heard an awful lot. If I could just ask, and I appreciate this is potentially quite a big topic, but just sort of headlines, please, maybe from Angela. We know that we are talking about a multi-year resource spending review, and one of the things that many of us on the committee are interested in is how we engage and how we ensure we get the right participation from people. Do you have any top tips for us, or any key recommendations for us to be thinking about as we think how we make our budget processes more participative, how we hear from the voices that we maybe haven't been hearing from in a way that still allows us to analyze data, gather expert evidence and all of that. I suppose it's specifically thinking in the context of the multi-year spending review. Thanks.
Very briefly, I think being proactive, much more proactive as a committee, but across across government as well, and across the Parliament, maybe bringing together different committees to do proactive engagement with a range of community organisations, and particularly around social care, particularly voices of unpaid carers who are accessing a range of services, so have a lot of experience of engaging in public services, but less experience in informing how those services are designed and delivered. I think there's also a need, and I say this with utmost respect, to build the knowledge base across parliamentarians and the range of functions within the Parliament from an equalities and human rights analysis perspective, so that the quality of the scrutiny and the analysis is more intense, more robust. I think I would also say the consultation and evidence request timescales recently have not supported effective participation or responses, and are the source of huge frustration to many of us, particularly in voluntary or unresourced roles,
but across the piece. And I think real consultation, it needs to be said, real consultation takes time and shouldn't be about creating what colleagues call busy work for the rest of us, which is, you know, external to government, where we effectively repeat evidence we have given on many occasions and we're asked to repeat it in successive consultations. I think it was very welcome to see a participation framework mentioned in the budget documents. I'd like to know more about that and know how participation in public finance decision making will be supported as that framework is developed. But there's really good stuff happening through the Fiscal Transparency Project coming out of Scottish Exchequer and open government and open budget work. And I'd like to see, and I think, you know, in answer to your question, how, you know, part of the how-to is make much better links across those different areas of work that are already going on.
That's really helpful. Thank you, Angela. I see Chris, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, it's just a very quick point, just to back up some of what Angela said now, is these things done well take time. It's almost February, the Spender Reviews used to be published in May, there's a traditional consultation out just now, people will be sitting in government writing this already. So I do think it's you know, it's a chance for the Parliament perhaps to be a bit more muscular, and because there, you know, what genuine ability is there for people to impact on the outcome of the spending review as we sit here today. The ship appears to me to be sailing, and I think it's a challenge for everyone involved in the process.
Thanks for that.